fact, I know that at this very moment we have three other parallel sessions going on, and we will try our best to give you enough stuff to keep you from leaving us. We have got an interesting lineup of speakers with us today. They come from every part of the M&D spectrum. Two of them work on very sharply focused research areas, applied nutrition and HIV. And then we have someone from JPAL, a very highly reputed organization on the research. And they use randomized evaluations in pretty much every sector that you can think of. Education, microcredit, energy, health insurance, and so on. One of our speakers comes from a technical support unit with government, and that's as close to government as you can get as an external consultant. And probably he will be able to tell us a lot about how to influence government, since he has been working with them so closely. I come from an NGO, and we practically get no government funding, and often are seen as critical of the policy decisions that government takes. So we are probably at the other end of the spectrum. May I now have the pleasure of having the speakers here. I will start by introducing Dr. Poornima Menon. Poornima is a senior research fellow at International Food Policy Research Institute, and she conducts applied nutrition research in the South Asia region with focus on programs and policies to improve maternal child nutrition. She is currently leading the evaluation team of Alive and Thrive, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation program in three countries. She also co-directs OCEAN, which is a new four-year initiative to build evidence, partnerships, and communications to improve nutrition policy in India. From 2001 to 2006, Dr. Poornima coordinated a collaborative research project to evaluate integrated food and nutrition program with IFPRI, Cornell, and World Vision. Let me also call upon Dr. Niranjan Sagurthi. He's the senior program officer at BMGF, a public health researcher with more than 20 years of experience behind him. He conducts diagnostic, experimental, and evaluation studies aimed at preventing HIV infection among most vulnerable groups. And his other areas of focus include sexual and gender-based violence. And I guess someone in the last session referred to domestic violence and sexual violence as an area where we should probably think of whether it's a good data to collect. Maybe we can hear some thoughts from him on that. He has led some seminal work on understanding the relationship between migration and HIV in India. And that seems to be a very interesting area to hear about. Let me also call upon stage Mr. Indrajit Chaudhary. Indrajit is the director for MLE, Monitoring, Learning and Evaluation, for Bihar Technical Support Program of Care India. He established the Concurrent Measurement and Learning Unit of Bihar PSU, which is rated as one of the biggest measurement efforts globally. It's supported by BMGF as well. And they collect and analyze data concurrently on reproductive, maternal, neonatal, and child health. And Mr. Chaudhary leads the MLE function of Bihar PSP, including concurrent measurement of outcomes through large-scale execution of LQAS methodology. He's also managing the implementation of all the innovations and strategic communication for the entire BTSP program. And lastly, I would invite Mr. Jasmine Shah. He's the Deputy Director for JPAL South Asia at IFMR, based in New Delhi. He leads the efforts to build partnerships with policymakers in the South Asia region to ensure that policy is driven by evidence. He also provides strategic oversight to capacity building portfolio under CLEAR program, and he supports the executive director in overall organizational strategy. He has mixed experience with the corporate sector as well, and a well-known civil society group in South India, Janagraha Center, and he has been involved with a large voter registration campaign. So we have a very diverse group of experienced evaluators right here, hoping to listen to them over the next 1 hour or so. We are running behind time, so I would request all the speakers to stick to time. We have 10 minutes for each of them. I would start by asking Dr. Poornima Menon to address the session.
Can you all hear me? Yes? Okay, great. It's really great to be with such a fun panel. I hope we have an exciting discussion. I don't have any PowerPoint or anything. I do have some brief prepared remarks on this issue of how do we get policy making to be more evidence-based. Those of us who do evaluations and work with data are always speaking about evidence-based or evidence-informed policy. So I want to talk very briefly about three sort of big ticket issues that come into play when we are talking about these. And there's plenty of background work that is written about these topics by political science predominantly. So the first is, if you want to inform policy, it's really important that we understand how policy is made, not in a formal sense, but how is it that certain policy decisions get made, and where does evidence fit with the larger bucket of issues that policymakers writ large think about when we are making policy? So the first is, for those of us who are purveyors and producers of evidence, in a sense, to fully reconcile within our world that, in fact, policymaking considers evidence very often, considers data very often, but also considers values, considers politics, considers money, considers how to reconcile where the policymaking is going to move with what are often divergent opinions, even among the people that are producers, generators, and promoters of evidence. So just, really broad scale acceptance in our community that, in fact, evidence is really just one of many considerations, and it doesn't matter which country you go to, this is the case. I have dual homes in the United States and here, and policymaking in the US and policymaking here are all subject to the same sets of issues around politics, values, money, influences from many different quarters that are not always speaking just about the evidence of the impact of the policy. So I think we need, as a community, to fully understand and absorb that, to read the material on that. It comes predominantly from political science. It doesn't come from evaluators talking about, this great thing. And the other piece is, of course, to recognize that there's a whole slew of decisions that are happening around policy making that relate to choice of interventions, that relate to choice of delivery platforms, that relate to choice of how, who's included and excluded when certain policies are made, especially in the social sector, and that every single one of those decisions is subject to the same set of issues that reconciles politics, values, evidence, etc. So that's one. There's a very thoughtful piece of work by the Overseas Development Institute, ODI, which has looked a lot at how research and evidence inform policy. A really thoughtful piece of work by, I think the author's name is Harry Jones. And it's written in a very accessible way, but it speaks to the issue of how do different people influence policy. And so I think the other thing for us to of course acknowledge and embrace is that many different people are trying to influence policy decisions. Not just people maybe like us who are coming from a more data-driven, there are so many poor people, you need to solve the problem of poverty, or in my case, there are so many undernourished people, you need to solve this problem, here are some solutions, here's what you need to do. But different people are influencing policy in different ways, and there's a really nice framework in the Jones paper that talks about the tactics that are used by these different groups of people. So the tactics include the kinds of things that people who are more in the evidence-based or research, evaluation, data landscape would do, which would be to advise. There are lobbying tactics that are often used to influence policy. There are confrontational tactics that are used by people who come from a more civil rights or rights-based activist type of perspective. And in all of these, a across all of these tactics that are used, there are either people that operate on the inside track, so you're really sort of working directly with a policymaker and, you know, have some kind of an inside track to influence them, or there's a set of people that work on an outside track perspective. Where in this spectrum do people who are, you know, are people who are researchers often fit? We often fit most often in the advising and outside track aspect of people that are trying to influence policy, when a lot of the other people that are trying to influence policy are working on advocacy, lobbying, inside track type of places. How then does policy move? How then does a policymaker make a decision that actually makes everyone happy in a sense? One way to get there is to recognize that convergence of asks, so that what an advocate in an inside track place is asking for and what a researcher who's writing publications and making an ask for, if those two are aligned, there's often very little space then for a policymaker to say, I'm sorry, we're just not going to go there. If young parliamentarians, civil rights activists, researchers, a technical community are all asking for the same thing, politicians and policymakers also sense less risk to their decisions because they are fundamentally also risk averse in the sense that they don't want to make things that will throw them out of elections the next time around, that will create such a big ruckus in the media that, you know, their reputations are damaged or that their chances of coming back are wrong. So I think as people like us who work on evidence-based or evidence-informed, so that the World Health Organization actually now doesn't use evidence-based anymore, they've changed the language to evidence-informed, recognizing that multiple things come into play. Where our groups like us come about is to firstly to recognize that landscape and recognize who's in that landscape, and then try and figure a way to actually see if we can move towards a convergence of asks of people in policy. In the nutrition space in India, it's, you know, we've managed to move somewhat in that direction. There's an active, reasonably active, somewhat loose group convened by something called the Coalition for Nutrition and Food Security. These entities themselves go through their ups and downs and ebbs and flows, but just the fact that you have a connecting mechanism at least helps to reconcile conflicting views within your own network of technical actors, and then you can say, you know, we make a collective ask, here are things that actually all of us agree upon, here are things around which there's some discord, and we may, you know, you may want to experiment or not go there. And it's a slow process, so that's the other thing that I think we all have to accept. I've been trying to put together sort of a 15 to 20 year timeline of policy decisions and movements in the policy landscape for nutrition as just part of an internal piece of work we've been doing, and it's been fascinating just to start to try and map that out and to understand that, to see all the ways in which government decisions and framing of the issue and all have moved, how that's been supported or challenged by people in different communities. But the main things are for us really recognizing the multitude of things that policymakers have to consider when making a decision, recognizing that we are not the only people in there, that we often have the most risky position because we don't work inside track and we don't do confrontation and we just don't do lobbying, kind of just say what's there and we hope somebody out there is really listening. How do you connect what we do with what people in those spaces are doing? I think is a really big, it's a really big issue for all of us to contend with. I think we've made some progress on nutrition here, and I'd be happy to, you know, offer some detail on that later if it comes about. We've explicitly taken quite a lot of this into consideration in the work we're doing on this initiative here called Potion, but it's slow moving. And then consider decentralized contexts, for example, in India, you know, center-state relationships, in 1 year, change in fiscal devolution, policy devolution, etc. It's a challenging landscape, but you've got to keep at understanding the politics. So I'll stop with that.
Purnima, you actually finished before time. Good to have that. give some extra time to other speakers. And good to listen to you discussing the entire policy making process and the challenges in the landscape, particularly for the evaluation community. I'll invite Niranjan to give his notes.
Thank you, Prasanth. What I'm going to do is not talk about HIV here and the migration linkage that, which actually has shown that the male migrant workers are at most risk for HIV, which changed the policy environment within India from the national AIDS control organization. That was in my previous role as a researcher at the Population Council, but I'm now going to talk from a foundation's perspective, the work that we are doing and how the evidence is used at each step of the decision making at various levels. So we have our friend Indrajit who will talk more details on the engagement that the technical support unit does at the state level, but I'll take a much more a macro perspective in terms of how the evidence is used in the decision making. And also go to a specific example of what evidence, how the evidence is leading into the improving the program impact at a local level. So let me start with saying the foundation together with the government and the non-governmental organizations has been working in the states of Bihar and UP to reduce the maternal neonatal and child mortality. As we all know that the foundation's work is not directly implementing interventions through the partners, but also it is through the government by providing the technical assistance and support, and which has an implicit theory that use the data and evidence at each step that you make decisions when you want to implement the program. And one of the, when we talk about reducing the maternal neonatal mortality, we largely talk about taking the example of how, where the deaths are occurring and how do we prevent maternal and neonatal mortality. What do the institutions or the government should take steps in that direction? So the main point that comes into the is the Lancet series published in 2010 as well as 12, talking about the newborn health, where they talk mainly around providing the intrapartum care, a good quality intrapartum care, which can actually improve save newborn lives as well as the maternal lives. Because the deaths that are largely taking place is because of the poor quality of care that's being provided at the facilities. And just to quote a very specific example in the state of Uttar Pradesh, we have the neonatal mortality of like 35 according to SRS. And then, that reminds me of today's morning panel discussion where Santosh has said about, raise the differences that we get from one source of data to the other source of data. I think that's obvious, but then we are living in the environment where we have to deal with different data sources. And then the, whereas the AHS data shows that for UP, neonatal mortality is 49 actually. So there is a, even if we take 35 as a conservative estimate for neonatal mortality, if we want to reduce it to meet the sustainable development goal of like 12, less than 12 per 1,000 live births, what do we need to do? And the research and the evidence has shown that a good quality intrapartum care can actually reduce the neonatal mortality. When we say the intrapartum care, there are some critical interventions that one can implement. That includes the administering the oxytocin as per protocol, or practicing KMC in case of the prematurity, even providing the skin-to-skin care services, timely initiation of the breastfeeding. So there are a list of key critical interventions that can be initiated to reduce the neonatal mortality as well as the maternal mortality, addressing the asphyxia. So what we did is in UP, we tried to understand what are the key causes of neonatal and the maternal death. And the major causes that comes is the prematurity. 30% of the neonatal deaths were happening due to prematurity. And 25% of the deaths are happening due to asphyxia. And about 20% of deaths are happening due to sepsis. So the evidence, this became a solid evidence for the technical support unit to talk to the government and take steps to initiate a nurse mentoring to improve the skills and of the staff nurse who are working in those facilities. So, but once the staff nurse is working, what kind of evidence or the data that we have to actually track that there is an improvement or the progress in those key intervention areas. So one of the key sources is the HMIs, you know, but then we all know that the HMI, the quality of the HMIs, it suffer from several issues that includes the completeness, correctness, or the timely reporting of the HMIs data. Although it has the good number of key indicators, but then the reported data is not of a great quality. So we have to, at the foundation, take decision to kind of monitor these key intervention areas at regular intervals of time, at a 6 month lead, doing the direct observation of deliveries in the facilities. I think maybe Inderjit can probably touch upon more when he describes the influencing the policy in case of Bihar. So what I'm trying to say is that the establishing or instituting that 6 month lead rapid rolling surveys actually help track the changes in the quality of care within those facilities where the nurse mentoring was initiated in both the states of Bihar and UP. And in UP, we saw that even with that 1 year of nurse mentoring intervention, there is an improvement in the KMC, there is an improvement in the administering the oxytocin as per protocol. There are several changes that we saw. And that became a solid evidence for the TSU to kind of talk to the government and say that this is an intervention, which is a promising intervention, and that can actually go into the overall Government of India's plan and for the state to initiate the nurse mentoring across the state. So that became an evidence. But then, you know, when we talk about evidence and the data, and that data using for the decision making at the local level, it requires a lot of commitment, and it is a both chicken and egg situation. That on the one hand, you need a good quality data to use it. But on the other hand, if your data is not showing good result or good things, then there is no motivation or incentive to use it. So there is a kind of a situation, but then what we believe is that both improving the data quality and tracking it over time and making effective use of that data can actually improve the program impact. And how we did it is by using the data dashboards at the state level, which compiles the information from different sources, and then putting them together and using that data dashboard in various reviews. So the review that happens at the district level with the CMOs coming together, and also the reviews that are happening at the state level where the Principal Secretary of Health, who actually looks at that data and take appropriate steps or issue the orders, government orders, or the guidelines to the facilities within the state. But then, you know, using that evidence or the data for making a big program impact or changing the policy or the way the government practices at the local level is only one side of the story. But the other side is that the ownership of that data and the motivation to identify the bottlenecks in the program of what's happening, what is the story behind that data, what do we need to really address, and then commitment to actually address those challenges is something that is what is can make every can make save lives of these newborns and mothers. So if both worlds work together in terms of not just using the evidence to make decisions, but then when decisions are made, identifying the challenges and bottlenecks to address those issues and implement them appropriately can actually save every life in the states that we work with. Thank you.
Thank you, Niranjan. fact, it's interesting to notice that both the speakers so far have touched upon intangible factors which really play a crucial role in the use of evidence in public policy. Like Purnima talked about things like the role of influencing groups, and the role of political groups, the value systems, and money in determining the direction of public policy. On the other hand, we have Niranjan talking about lack of commitment at the local level in the government, particularly when the results of an intervention don't show up to be very positive. And there's a lack of ownership and motivation to look at the story behind the data as it is. I will now invite Indrajit to make his presentation.
Some of the things that Niranjan was talking about, I'll probably repeat some of them as well. We started working in Bihar in the year of 2010, end of 2010, and initially started as an integrated family health initiative, and slowly in 8 districts of Bihar. And with a lot of ambitious goals to reduce maternal mortality rate and neonatal mortality rate, malnutrition, total fertility rate, so those kind of, all those big ambitions. And we tried to work in these 8 districts for a few years, around 2 years, and then scaled it up to the entire state in starting November 2013. So there are lots of partners. I'm not being talking about all of them, but they were like all different partners who are working with CARE to implement the entire program. In 2011, it was basically implementation design. 2011 and 13, there were we tested different solutions and built proof of concepts. And from November 2013 onwards, it was scale up. So that was a basic timeline. I'll talk about here where the measurement took a role. So measurement was at the core of, and still is, at the core of whatever we do. So in the implementation design, certainly secondary research data was one of the most important thing that we are using. In 2011 and 13, and that was the most important part when the data got used, like when solutions got implemented in these 8 districts, we kept on continuously measuring results and to assess the efficacy of the solution as well as to learn from that and build evidences. So there was I'll talk about a kind of robust outcome measurement system we had. And then 2013 onwards, when we started doing scale up of different solutions within the government, by the government, and also tried to work with the government on the health system strengthening aspects, we created a mechanism called concurrent measurement and learning mechanism that I'll speak about. But through all of this, I'm trying to say that through the overall trajectory, the way the measurement works has changed, but the measurement was a continuous part of the entire journey. So concurrent measurement and learning, I'll say it's a quite an ambitious initiative. The concept specifically talks about, like, we need to concurrently measure, track effectiveness of implementation, provide strategic guidance, and generate knowledge and evidence on a continuous basis. I'll say it's a kind of a merging scientific rigor of measurement as well as program requirement. Like, what program requires is real-time data in a quick, swift turnaround time, which is relevant for them, and analyzed and presented in a way that people at the bottom level policymakers to the people who are working at the block level officials, all of them understand in their own way. So we try to merge both these concepts, like with the rigor, scientific rigor, and the requirement of the program. So there are three basic things that we do as a part of concrete measurement and learning. Of course, the one is continuously measuring effectiveness of implementation through tracking outcomes of specific solution or as well as a package of intervention. And we continuously measure them. For specific solutions, we have robust measurement like RCTs and all. For tracking, we have others, lot of different surveys, population level surveys, and many other tools to track progress. Then, of course, analytics and exploration, as our in morning session was talking about, is more important to find the meaning from the data and not just the data. So it's like analytics and a lot of exploratory research and exploratory studies that we keep on doing in order to answer different strategic questions. And of course, capture learning. And overall, this can create evidences for influencing policy and, more importantly, deciding for scale-up. I'll talk about, so there have been lots of solutions, lots of measurements. I'll not have enough time to talk about that. I'll just give a glimpse of a few solutions. I'll specifically talk about four solutions which are most interesting and important and most successful. One was subcenter platform meeting. It's a meeting of ASHA, Anganwadi worker, and at the subcenter level to review the review plan and do supportive supervision, which for us was one of the major lever for bringing changes on the ground. So we started doing it from April 2012. We measured it through concurrent surveys in the population on the outcomes, and those outcomes are like exclusive breastfeeding rate or complementary feeding rate or institution delivery. So those kind of outcomes are continuously measured. So and it got scaled up now, starting from 2014, it has got scaled up in the entire state. I'll talk about the kind of data in my later slides. Quality improvement and mobile nurse mentoring, which we are doing from September 2012. And there are various measurement mechanisms over there. The most important over there, as Niranjan was saying, is a direct observation of delivery. Somebody, some nursing trained nurse stay there in the labor room for the entire duration of delivery and keep a checklist and observe it. So that was quite an interesting concept and which brought a lot of interesting results. And two other innovations I'll just glimpse on are team-based goals and incentive and ICT-based trial on mobile health. And both of them were randomized controlled trials that we have done. So I tried to keep four different kinds of things so that we cover it a little bit. I'll not go into the details of these indicators and all. It is like through our population level data, we continuously try to look into, and I've just shown two data points, but it is not two, it's continuous data points. I'm showing just two different rounds, like round we have done in 2012 and 2014. So the different, and we continuously showed difference which proven the efficacy of and effectiveness of the subcenter platform meeting solution delivery, and which was one of the major reason for scaling it up in the entire state. Again, like for quality improvement things, if I talk about just one, two important indicators, like oxytocin administration within 1 minute is a very, very important intervention for saving mother from postpartum hemorrhage. When we entered Bihar, it was around at 12%, and which increased to 25% in all the facilities just with quality improvement work. But with mobile nurse mentoring, it has increased to around 60%. So the current situation is like that. So this kind of data kept showing the how different interventions are actually working. Working or not working, I'm showing only successful interventions. There are quite a lot where we stagnated, we didn't work, we had to change the strategy to make it work. So I'll not go into the specific details of this data. I'll just talk about one was this team-based goals and incentive. As you know, in the entire frontline worker scenario, there is a lot of demotivation. There is no intrinsic or extrinsic motivation factors are really, really low. So we tried to come up with a new interesting solutions of strengthening a teamwork and motivation through non-monetary incentive to group of frontline workers. And it was a randomized control trial. We did it these were simple household items or certificates by the district magistrate. And as a result of that, we have seen the kind of outcome level indicators, the way it has changed. It is like, you can see the received immunization, breastfeeding, complementary feeding, all those kind of indicators actually improved. Similarly, on the other innovation was on using a comprehensive mHealth solution, digitizing the entire work of frontline worker. So it has also shown through RCT results continuous improvement between the treatment and control areas. So now I'll say the kind of policy influence and scale up that we could do with these four in these four areas. For subcenter platform meeting, the government of Bihar had scaled up subcenter meetings in the entire state. It got included in the PIP of NRHM. It has got influence in the outside Bihar also. There was national guideline which was on HSC meeting. HSC meeting and incremental learning has been a part of the ISNIP program of World Bank, and which is being currently implemented in 8 states in India. This AAA platform, which is being done in UP and also is being done currently in Rajasthan. So there are quite a few areas in which the things have actually moved. While talking about this, there are other examples. I'm not going into details because there's just 1 minute left. I want to speak one very important things that I believe are core to entire our work. First of all, our entire effort was not towards lobbying or doing advocacy or using evidence for motivating government to do something. It was more of a commonsensical approach to what actually works on the ground and the kind of which can be scaled up by the government, as well as which is sharp enough to bring changes. What we have kept doing was kept measuring it on a continuous basis and throwing the information, throwing those evidences to various different stakeholders. And the improvement is, and whatever has happened over a period of time, is just because this continuous showing of evidence. Evidence, as Purnima was saying, actually it requires a convergence of us, and it starts from the block level, district level. If people in the government sector, they get motivated, then they start asking. If the ask comes from there, then it makes much more easier than an NGO-led advocacy. It makes much easier if it comes from the government, through the government, and through the system. So that is one of our biggest and most important policy influence was the scale up of mobile health intervention, which is currently being scaled up by Women and Child Development Department, as a mobile phone will be given to all the Anganwadi workers, so it's being scaled up nationally. So there are things that can be done by simply doing rigorous measurement and continuously showing those evidences to different stakeholders at different levels. Thank you.
Thanks, Anjali. Very interesting presentation, and particularly the part about mobile nurse mentoring and how the whole process was directly observed. And that turns out to be a very new technique of monitoring. You also presented some really visible examples of success of evidence. With your recommendations getting accepted in the national guidelines, the state NRHM, PIP, and so on. And that's really heartening to see. That's the real power of evidence. I will now invite Jasmine to present his.
to talk like the first two speakers as well. Thank you to the organizers for inviting us. What I will sort of talk about is on the broad theme that, and this is sort of almost an assimilation of the last several years of experiences that researchers affiliated with JPAL have had working very closely with policymakers to do evaluations of a wide range of policies. And the broad theme that or trend that we see is that to really increase the use of rigorous evidence in policy making, there is a real need to engage policymakers in actually generating that evidence itself. So now I want to start by first actually saying that, you know, policymakers often do use data. It's not that policymakers do not use data, but the problem lies in a couple of key you know, areas. So one is that the data that they use is often not reliable, right? The way it's collected, the integrity of the data, the security, people who are collecting it may not have the incentives to collect reliable data. And it is often unrepresentative data. You know, there are many times you will listen policymakers relying on anecdotal evidence, you know, site visits that they have been taken to by the junior officials, then to determine whether certain policies are working or not working. The second issue is that most often they rely on administrative data. They call this the MIS data, and even other kinds of data. It could be survey data, but often data which does not yield causal inferences. And therein lies the problem. You know, many times when, yes, at the time of making decision, implicitly you're making a causal link between what you see or what you're trying to decide on with factors influencing it. And if the underlying set of data or evaluation does not yield that causal link, then of course you're going to you know, end in probably imprecise policies. But what about cases when policymakers actually commission evaluations? Even over here, we see the status quo is not something that leads to effective use of evidence in policymaking. You know, oftentimes evaluations are commissioned not at the critical juncture when policymakers are debating between policy options. You know, many times we see evaluations being commissioned because it is a requirement, maybe donors have asked for it, maybe decisions have already been taken, programs have, you know, you've invested 5,000 crores in a particular program, and at the end of 3 years you want to say, you know, things worked or not. And again, there the incentives are not right to even bring up some, you know, critical sort of findings. And assuming even all these conditions are met, we also see many cases when policymakers, even they commission evaluation with the right, I would say, intent to say that, you know, I want to understand what are the policy options on the table, which of them will actually give me the kind of outcome that I'm interested in. They often stay disengaged during the process of evidence generation. Now, I think all of us who worked on generating evidence understand that especially good evaluations and impact evaluations take anywhere between 1 to 2 years. And howsoever interested or enthusiastic the policymaker is at the point when they commission evaluation, if the only time they are going to hear about the outcome is a year or two from then when the final results come up, most likely the person's not there. Second, even if they are there, you know, it's not, that's not their, you know, at the top of their mind. You know, their mind is shifted, they are on some other zone. So I think these are all the obstacles and factors that we've often seen why rigorous evidence does not find a place in policymaking as often as we would all like. And this is, of course, absolutely acknowledging all that, you know, the other speakers have said. There are a lot of other factors that go into policymaking. But even with policymakers who do value evidence, there are these other factors. So my argument here today would be that to increase the use of rigorous evidence in policymaking, there are two kinds of, I would say, key areas of action that I would propose for all of us as evaluators and broadly in the evaluation community. First is that evaluators need to engage with policymakers to help them understand the value of good evidence, right? Just by saying use data for decision making, we do not see that cutting the ice. They do rely on data, they do see all kinds of data, but helping them understand what is good evidence, what kinds of evidence to rely at what point of, you know, life cycle of decision making, and where all these different evidences fit in is something extremely valuable. This does not happen in one meeting or one training or a capacity building session. It happens over several conversations and deep engagement with policymakers. And the second is actually involving them very, very closely in the process of evidence generation. So at JPAL, we do impact evaluations, and there are several ways in which we try to do this. One is, of course, if the person or if the policymaker is so inclined to participate in the evaluation as say one of the researchers, you know, some of them do have a bent of mind to actually very closely ask the kind of questions and then stay involved. So that's of course very welcome. But even if that is not the case, there is a lot of useful process data that gets generated in any good impact evaluation. And there's no reason to hold them off of policymakers. And we very often do that. You know, we share that data. In fact, in many times to build the appetite of policymakers before we get into a long evaluation, we do brief scoping studies just so that they see what is good data and see how could that actually influence their future decision. So with those sort of broad opening remarks, I want to talk about a couple of case studies of projects or impact evaluations JPAL have done, where policymakers have been very closely involved and which eventually have been scaled up, one at a state level and the other at a national level. And if time permits, I'll also talk about a new collaboration that we're having in the state of Tamil Nadu, where we're actually engaging with policymakers in a very different manner. So the first case study that I'm going to talk about is impact evaluation that we did with the government of Gujarat, specifically the Gujarat Pollution Control Board. The problem over there was essentially unregulated water and air pollution of the most polluting industrial units in Gujarat. So they have Schedule 1 and Schedule 2 industries. And Gujarat always had, I think it was one of the first states to use third-party audits. You know, the High Court had mandated third-party audits for all industrial units. But the problem there was that at that point in time, when before the policymakers approached JPAL, the industrial units were supposed to hire their own auditors, right? And they were supposed to make the payment to the auditors, and then the auditors would submit a report to GPCP whether their emissions would fall within a certain norm or not. So very clearly, you see there is a conflict of interest here. And over time, they realized that even though every industry would submit a report, many of them would actually be fudged report, and you couldn't point it out until you go and do back checks, etc. But the GPCP did not have that kind of a wherewithal or a bandwidth. So the intervention that was tried out over here, and again, I see that the timing and the involvement between the policymakers and researchers is important over here. It was the member secretary of the GPCP who was very closely involved. This was a real question, burning question. You know, somebody had filed a PIL in the High Court that all this third-party audit system is not working, it should be dismantled. And that was the time when this conversation started, and a new sort of almost a framework of regulation was tested. It was a randomized controlled trial tested in around 400 industrial units. And what the regulatory framework, the way it was changed was that third-party audits were conducted, but industries would not pay directly to the auditors or pick their auditors. They would pay into a common central pool. And the auditors were empaneled directly by GPCB and assigned randomly to one of the industrial units. So you've broken that link of conflict of interest. In addition, what was also done is around 10% of these auditors were randomly back-checked by GPCB. So there was an incentive that if still the auditors would collude with the industries, you know, they would be caught. So this system was, you know, of course, a lot of details were put in place and tried and tested, and they found really remarkable decrease. In fact, they found first remarkable accuracy of reporting, and in the second year of the intervention, in response to accurate reporting, the industries reduced their pollution. Throughout this entire phase, the entire GPCB team and JPAL researchers were quite closely engaged, and even after the research sort of ended around 2013, there was a lot of internal momentum to see now how do we take these results and scale it up. In January 2015, GPCB made this as the new third-party audit system in the state of Gujarat. And a lot of this happened because the champion was not somebody from outside or at JPAL trying to very deeply engage. Yes, we were all engaged, but the lead was taken by the member secretary of GPCB. The second example is an intervention that we tested in Bihar. And this was something that was led by the principal secretary of Bihar at that time, which was Dr. Santosh Mathew. And he was one of the co-researchers in a group of researchers which included Dr. Rohini Pandey, Abhijit Banerjee, Esther Duflo, and Clement Imbert. And they studied essentially a new fund flow architecture for one of the, you know, well-known centrally sponsored scheme, which is the NREGA. So the problem over there was, we all know there is a lot of delays in NREGA payment. As well, there is a huge time lag between when a particular allocation is requested by a panchayat and when the fund flows. And again, I would not go into too many details, but essentially the reform, what it did was, rather than an allocation based funds transfer, the fund flow reform made it an expenditure based fund transfer, where in real time, when a panchayat actually incurs expenditure under NREGA, it electronically requests a central pool of funds, and within 24 hours the fund is transferred. It sounds very simple, but technologically it took quite some effort. It was a very large trial, randomized at the block level, 1,000 panchayats in control group, 1,000 panchayats in treatment groups, and we find at the end of the day there was close to 24% reduction in leakages of funds, and it's a substantially large number. And it took a lot of effort to even do this on a RCT basis, because of course, you know, if there are reduction in leakages, nobody is going to stay silent. And an irony is, at the end of the RCT, there was so much of the system pressure on the system that Bihar rolled this back, and they went back. But at least the study completed, it had fantastic results. What happened after the study is also very interesting. And I'll take that last minute, I have to actually finish this story, because it sort of goes back to the point that, you know, the way policy making happens, there are so many hurdles to be crossed, so many things that need to be aligned, that if you are alone going to be doing this, if you're not co-opting a policymaker inside who understands this and wants to push this internally, it's very difficult to make this happen. Since then, in 2013, I think we finished this study. Fortunately or luckily, the joint principal secretary became the joint secretary MORD. And there was a lot of internal momentum. You know, this was presented at the very high levels, at the CA's office, at the PMO. Finally, this study has been referred and cited to in this year's economic survey. And last year, there was a cabinet note that actually said that the fund flow for NREGA, and not just NREGA, I think over time, many other centrally sponsored scheme, should be redesigned so that it is not an allocation-based fund transfer, but an expenditure-based real-time transfer. And that reduces a lot of levels and leakages. So it already has been today scaled up in the entire state of Kerala. This year, it's going to be scaled up in 10 states, and hopefully in a couple of years, at least for NREGA, all the particulars, all the states of India. So again, I think the broad point being, there are many ways, I would say, of, you know, how evidence can influence policy, and it doesn't. And I've cited only examples where you're doing the studies in the states or contexts where you eventually are hoping for a scale up. And there are various ways, but I think this one of the interesting trends that we're seeing is there is absolutely no, comparison of cases where you have very closely aligned with the policymakers and have ensured that they stay engaged in the process of evidence generation. Thank you.
Thanks, Jasmine. So we heard from him some really great examples of how evidence collection has led to change in situations, particularly in Gujarat, where the pollution by industries actually reduced. And this was done through a very effective system where they actually ensured during the process of data collection that collusion will happen between auditors and industry. The NREGA example is also quite powerful, where as a result of the evaluation, they finally managed to reduce the leakages of funds from the system. One important point he made was about how much it matters that the bureaucrats, the policy makers, the decision makers remain engaged with the process of collection of evidence and actually own up to the evidence. And here I have a story which I will finish with in a minute. My own experience also is nothing different from this. I believe acceptance of evidence within government is really a matter of culture. And that hasn't changed over the years. I would refer to one major survey which the Government of India commissioned to us in one of my earlier avatars, where I was managing the governance reform program in Andhra Pradesh as part of the Center for Good Governance. we used to take up studies on conservancy for the Government of India, and one of the major assignments they gave us was to conduct a state of civil services survey. They initially called it a state of civil services, and we were virtually asked to reach out to every single bureaucrat at every level in 10 major services, including the Oil and Gas Services, Central Services, and talk to them about the conditions in their service, their work environment, their work-life balance, their discrimination and harassment situations at work. Some of this was obviously, a lot of it was obviously very sensitive. And when the final report came out, and it's still there on the website of the organization, it's still within public domain. The government, when they saw the responses, and some of the responses were pretty explicit, because they actually gave the respondent an opportunity to write down their experiences, not just ticking the boxes. And it was completely anonymous. So people really came out with their pain points. There were cases of caste-based discrimination at very high level in government among civil servants. And the result was that the government finally stopped short of calling it a state of civil services survey. They simply called it civil services in India a survey. And it was commissioned by no less than the highest level of government in India. So there is definitely a great deal of need for appetite for taking negative feedback, negative evidence, which doesn't go your way. Also, there are other bottlenecks like the perceived importance of the sector where you are collecting the evidence. I worked for Save the Children, and a number of times the evidence we have collected hasn't really got the due importance, because children, and particularly vulnerable children, segments like street children, are not really seen as an important segment of society. So no matter how robust the evidence that you create, the perceived importance of that piece of evidence is really low. Also, the context in which you collect the evidence is very important. Very often in India, and I'm sure everybody present here would agree, evidence that you cite from international data is challenging India. They say you can't really compare India with Russia, India with China, India with Brazil. And a lot of times this is just a defense mechanism that they want to use. But they are simply not willing to implement that evidence into practice. Before I open this up for questions from the audience, I would just rapidly go over the points made by the earlier speakers. Purnima, I think, referred to a framework on tactics used by different influence groups, which I believe must be a very interesting piece of analysis. And maybe I would myself look it up on the net just to know how different people actually influence policy making. I think Indrajit referred to mHealth and the whole work of digitizing the work done by frontline health workers. In fact, I would like to start the question and answer session by asking him, this sort of work, like using mHealth or similar mobile solutions, has been done by a number of other organizations also. And maybe all of them have some success story to tell. But how are we really using this collective evidence coming from different quarters? BMGF has something to say. I'm sure BBC has something to say on the way they have used such solutions for communication strategies. I think there's a lot that the fraternity of evidence generation has to do in using this all collectively and showing the bigger picture to the world. Okay, I would now like to open up for the audience. I'm sure there are a lot of people. Yeah. Please introduce yourself. And
Mr. Chairman, you talked about the importance of culture within government, which sort of, in a sense, there's a notion of that we know it and how are you going to change that culture? The only way you might think about changing that culture within government is if the incentives for bureaucrats change. And the incentives can only become responsive to evidence and to data if the incentive or bias in favor of their promotions being determined by outcomes and outputs and not by ensuring inputs. Inputs essentially, has the money been spent? Have the UCs, the utilization certificates, been provided to the higher level? And then the money will get released in any case. And 1.5, 2 years down the road, the officer will move on to doing another job. This is the culture in which the following thrives. And I'd like your views on whether there are sort of ways of dealing with this. The following thrives, meaning a notion that 25 years ago I was collector and DM, and this is my experience from those days, and this is still valid today. So A, problem is anecdotal evidence is being used, and B, 25-year-old anecdotal evidence is being used. The other reason why the culture doesn't develop, and this is my last point, is that unlike in China, where outputs and outcomes are actually taken into account in promotions of cadres and of civil servants, the result in China is that, you know, a big program will never go to scale unless it's been piloted. Unless there's been an experiment in a, you know, when they did the household reform, the household responsibility system, in other words, went from collective agriculture to, 30-year leases for private plots were given. They did a pilot. You can never think of a pilot being done in this country because you are never expected to produce outputs once your program goes to scale. You're just going to be measured in any case on inputs. So that's the problem. I'd like the views of the panel on this.
Yeah. Other questions, please?
I'm Anuradha from the Jindal School of Government and Public Policy, and I'm asking this, it's a wonderful panel because we've been talking about this as the keywords for almost like a century, but my questions are specific to Jasmine Shah and Indrajit. Jasmine Shah, you made a very valid point in the sense you said rigorous evidence doesn't find a place in policy making in most circumstances. Let's take that as the assumption that it doesn't exist. So, I'm asking this question because I serve as program evaluation officer at the United Nations Secretariat Ban Ki-moon's office, and we always felt that in social sector programs, especially where developmental programs like WFP and other places like UNDP, we always thought there was an element of principal agent crisis existing. I know you have worked wonderfully in Gujarat and Tamil Nadu. I want you to throw a light on specifics of that. It'd be very interesting to hear that, to say if you at all faced a principal agent problem in your data actually, you know, not being evidence-based, but it's being actually steered. Because I think, if I've caught it right, you also mentioned that policy makers have to be a part of evidence-making. I think that completely conflicts the idea of, you know, defeating that kind of a, you know, biased thing. So maybe your views. My question to Indrajit is, it's very, very interesting to see somebody working so well in Bihar, all the four initiatives that you mentioned, especially people who work with different, I'm sure Preston will also agree that it's very challenging. My specific question is, the most interesting thing that you mentioned is efficacy and effectiveness. It's great to see think tank or an NGO talking much in terms of efficacy and effectiveness rather than talking in terms of, you know, just the impact for individuals. I wanted you to say specifically on, has there been any causal linkages or proxy indicators? Because it's not what we actually intend to see is something like a process indicators or output indicators. But most of the time in grassroots level initiatives, you see that the causal linkages are proxy indicators and never demonstrated. And I think your case is a very, very straight, specific, health-specific initiators, where I'm sure there would have been plenty of those. Did you at all come across any of those? So those are my specific questions. Thanks.
So, thanks, Anuradha. We have a third question as well.
Good afternoon, this is Vinod, working for Care India. I'm from Chennai. So, maybe specific to Indian context, as someone told that when evidence is shared and there is a escape mechanism saying it is India, not China or Russia or USA. That can be taken as an escape mechanism also, but then how reliable and contextual it would be to draw evidence from one part of our country, let's say from Gujarat, for example, and then look for scalability and sustainability, applying it in Tamil Nadu. So, how that part could be addressed as a evidence generating professionals, how that can be contextualized and then could be used, rather saying it cannot be used, how it can be contextualized and then could be used in different contexts that you are planning to work or you are working. So, some clarity on that would help. Thank you.
So this is Jaz from Breakthrough. I have a question for Mr. Jasmine. You referred in the presentation the use of process monitoring data for supporting policy change. So would you cite some examples where you actually done it, where more of the process monitoring data was used for policy change? And the next, Mr. Indrajit, is two of the RCDs done here in Bihar. So I'd be keen to know in one of your nursing program, I think it's a 2-year RCT model you've done it. How frequently the data was collected, and was it collected A for your daily intervention, like the when your visit is an intervention per se, or was it generally for the impact level indicators or your theory of change promotion to that? Thank you.
Yes, because I'm sure there the panelists also like to speak, but I can talk about a little more length if others, people would like to. So, first question on Mr. Mehrotra's question on changing the culture and how can we encourage policymakers to do pilots and then scale up. Now again, I think none of us can talk about it in a representative manner, but we have actually seen even in India and many state governments, talk about this idea of doing pilots. Yes, we've done this in here and then we are scaling up, but I think what is really lacking, and I would love to hear more about instances in China, because I haven't heard of systematic piloting and testing being done before policies being scaled up anywhere in the world, let alone India. But we have seen often people say that they are piloting it, but the scale of the pilot, the way data is collected during pilot, and can you draw causal inferences then to say, okay, now I'm going to devise a 1,000 or 10,000 crore policy based on this, that is where I think the problem lies. And that is where I think the work Care India is doing in Bihar, which is, yes, you're piloting different things, but there's a very strong measurement and monitoring back into this entire piloting is what we would believe makes the difference. This is also something similar to what JPAL is trying to do in Tamil Nadu, where we have a multi-year collaboration. We are working across 6 to 7 departments, rural development, health, education. In many cases, even before the RCT phase, we are doing short scoping studies, getting data, then feeding them into a real sort of, at scale RCT, and data from that then informs state policy. Of course, I think there the culture and the incentives of bureaucrats really comes into play. I will not even venture into answering how can we change those incentives. Second, in terms of principal agent issues, so yes, I think it is an important question, but I would say at the end of the day, this boils down into the credibility of institution doing research. Any type of good evaluation needs a collaboration between the implementer and the researcher, right? And I'm sure you would have known multiple cases where even though there is a hands length collaboration, you're not very sure whether this is reliable evaluation data or not. So at least in JPAL, we have very clear, transparent MOUs of which states what academic independence means, who collects the data, who looks at it. In most cases, when we do have policymakers as OPIs, they give inputs into the design of the research and maybe helping sort of devise the randomization and stuff like that, but not actually data collection or final. Maybe they even actually help in inferencing from data, because that is where the contextual information comes in. So I would say it all goes back to the credibility of the organization and the transparency of the agreement that you had up front. Assumptions for external validity, how do you know if I think this is a large question. I think this needs a longer discussion, but yes, it. First of all, you cannot make any, I would say, statement, overarching statement about how generally how generalizable evaluations are. It always depends on the specific intervention, the specific context, and all I can say is that if you have studied the theory of change of the particular intervention, and if you clearly recognize what are the assumptions underlying every aspect of your theory of change, you can then take an informed call whether an intervention in Bihar is applicable in Kerala or not. So that's my brief answer. And process monitoring data, I'll give another example of the work that was done in evaluating the impact of the smart cards program in Andhra Pradesh. This is something which Professor Karthik Muridharan, Sandeep Sukthankar and Paul Newhouse have done. Excellent paper, again cited in the economic survey last year. And there it was trying to see whether smart cards at the individual level and biometric authentication reduces leakages again in NREGA and social security pension. And it was again a one and a half year evaluation, but there was a lot of, I would say, almost a curiosity or thirst from policymakers to say we can't wait for this long. But we know that to get good impact evaluation data, we had to wait for that long. So what we did was we actually embedded a team within the Rural Development Department in Andhra Pradesh, which collected all the process data. In their formal quarterly reviews, all this data was presented to the government, and they used a lot of it to actually smoothen out the implementation. So even good process data at least gets them to see that this is reliable, and the fact that 1 year or 1.5 years wait is going to be worth it. So I'll leave it at that.
I think Indrajit, you had a couple of questions. One was probably about the state specific examples of causal data. Is that
right? Yeah, so probably I'll start with that mHealth question. There are a number of success stories, lots of people are doing it, and how we went about it. I'll say it is the way Purnima was mentioning. I like this thing that this convergence of asks and collaborating between all others. As for example, when in Bihar, we started with this MMO pilot. DFID was having some other work over there, as well as OPM, Oxford Policy Management, was also doing some kind of pilot with mHealth. So we very again Santosh Mathu during that time, WCD, so we banked on him again. And the way IPMS got developed in Bihar was actually taking it from all the different partners. And BDC Media Action and us, we are working together, like on the same brand. So all the different partners working together, we all made it together to work it out. So it's similar. Same is the experience when we are going to do it at the national level as well. So so that is one. Like regarding proxy indicators and probably how. Probably things take a lot of time to change on the ground, and as Jasmine was saying very, very interestingly, that like you won't have one single officer over there, one person over there for the it will be there for some 3 to 6 months and then move on, and you won't have the next person will not be interested in the kind of thing you started with or he started with. So you require something continuously. Giving, feeding them up. So as I was showing in one of my slides, one of my major principle over here is merging the scientific rigor along with program relevance. That is, I think, is a key to success, or whatever we could do is one of the key was that. So bringing out continuous proxy data on different kind of indicators, because things at the outcome level won't change probably 1 year, But continuously coming out with some output level indicators or other proxy indicators for that was a continuous effort. As far as RCTs are concerned, we had all the outcome level indicators and the change we have seen in the outcome level indicators, though there were process data continuously, process data and output level data continuously gathered as well. But when we look into the success of any program, when we talk about it at any forum or any level, at a higher level, what gets most used is the outcome level data. But when you talk at a district level, the functionaries at the block level, what gets most appealing to them is the process level data, some output level indicators, which they have never seen to change, is changing probably through your intervention. They become your collaborator to actually ask these at the state level when we go. We have already created a base of align with us. So, and of course a very important thing that outcome measurement, and if promotion can be done to outcome measurement, and we love it, I'm not sure.
Well, a beginning was made in the government through, you know, adoption of result framework documents by the ministries, and to keep a closer track of the progress made by government schemes. And probably that can feed into performance monitoring of bureaucrats. But any change at that level would certainly take time to come. Till then, I think we'll continue to have the bureau and the CRs to look at the promotions and the incentives. I had one question for Purnima, since she comes from the nutrition research sector. The whole debate about the RMTF being adopted by the government system in India continues today, and there is hardly any final verdict on that. So how strong really is the evidence for adoption of therapeutic foods in the SDS system, and how soon do you think that Indonesia is going to follow?
I just want to respond to a couple of the earlier comments there. Firstly, I think that despite the fact that the incentive system for bureaucrats in the government is unlikely to change for a long time, I actually see that things today around evaluation, acceptance of data, use of data, use of evidence, you know, knowledge of evaluations, etc., is in a much better place than it was 7-8 years ago. Just the fact that, you know, there are so many more of us actually saying the same things around evidence informed policy, around the role of rigorous evaluations. We are all working with government counterparts on these. Not a single evaluation of anything in a state is being done without bureaucrats and you know, program managers being involved and informed. And that leads to a shift in culture and language in the use of evidence and data. So I think we should actually feel quite optimistic about this and just keep at it, because I do think that even if the explicit culture change in terms of incentives hasn't moved and may not move, there are implicit culture changes and people are asking questions about outcomes, etc. So I do want to say that I think the question about also what's transferable in terms of experiences from one state to the next, India has come to a point where we are seeing more and more with the same policy framework. So say the same NAREGA, the same ICDS, the same NRHM policy framework, very different results in terms of implementation, even of those schemes in different states. And that I think gives us real opportunities to ask some of those state-to-state questions and really start to dig into, well, with the same policy framework, the same set of interventions you're trying to roll out, what has made certain things work in say in Orissa compared to a Bihar or in a, you know, there are also states with similar enough context but very different results on policy implementation, that those conversations are, we are very ready, I think, for those conversations, and it's up to people like us to convene those around thematic areas. So I do think that, but it has to be done with a lot of caution, and like how Jasmine, where you went with that, was really great. The issue of evidence related to therapeutic foods in India, etc., it's been a contentious issue in the nutrition field, but I think part of it relates to how the issue came to the policy table. In a sense, it came to the policy table in a space of confrontation and sort of fairly adversarial sets of public debate among different people in the nutrition community. It should never have come to the policy table in that form. If it had come to the policy table with more dialogue, with more agreement on what evidence needed to have been built around the use of therapeutic foods for nutrition in India 3 years ago, we might be in a better place. That said, I know that there's several people who've been experimenting, you know, doing RCTs, doing operational experiments, etc., around precisely that. And maybe today there's been a big, huge RCT that was done just around the product itself by a very credible researcher. You know, maybe the time is right today to have that internal conversation in the nutrition community with people who are opposed to the idea, with people who are on the fence, with people who are really pro, to say, look, what are the circumstances under which something like this is needed, and what should our collective responsibility or recommendation to the government be? It's a kind of thing that a group like, say, the Nutrition Coalition or, you know, more neutral party group that isn't working on that set of topics should actually take on to convene and pull consensus around. So I think there's lessons to be learned around that from how, you know, things moved into the policy community without, or to the public eye of the debate, without technical and operational issues having actually been discussed by researchers and advisors, if you will, to the policy group. So I don't personally have an opinion on it. I do think it needs to be much more grounded. I think there is more evidence emerging on it, and it's a good time to convene a dialogue and a consensus statement around it, but by a very usual set of people who don't have a stake in the decision, for example. That if you have that done by people who have a stake in the decision, you've lost the battle right there.
Thanks, Munima, and that's pretty much an optimistic note for us to wrap it up. She says that there is more optimism today and more greater readiness to accept Indians than before. With that, we would end this session, and I thank the speakers for bringing extremely high quality to the discussion and the audiences for their questions. Thank you very much.